We've always known there's a lot of power in these old Enterprise GPUs, but being able to use them for anything outside of machine learning, or as a dedicated NVENC card, has always been a little challenging. Today, I'm going to show you how to breathe some fresh life into your home lab by using any GPU inside of a virtual machine, letting you play games, edit videos, and take advantage of the horsepower these cards have to offer. Let's get started. If you've ever thought about running your own servers for home or business use, but don't want to deal with the headaches of maintaining hardware, why not let Linode host your services for you? They make it simple to deploy and manage your own cloud infrastructure, with solutions ranging from a single shared CPU to massive multi-core virtual machines. You can even add in dedicated enterprise GPUs for machine learning. With shared CPU plans starting at as little as $5 per month and scaling up to as high as you need to go, you'll be able to find a hosting plan that fits your needs. They also have 24/7 365 support available, regardless of your plan size. That's a better support plan than I have on my personal server rack, I can tell you that much. Visit linode.com/craftcomputing and get a $100 60-day credit just for signing up for a new account. That's linode.com/craftcomputing. And thanks to Linode for sponsoring today's video. Welcome back to Craft Computing, everyone. As always, I'm Jeff. For the last few weeks, I've been pretty focused on these NVIDIA Tesla cards, trying to figure out the best way to put them to use. I've done some benchmarking on the Tesla K80 and the Tesla M40, and while they perform well in a desktop PC, they're also not designed to be ran in a desktop tower. In my last video, I focused on trying to cool the Tesla M40 while trying to keep the noise at an office-friendly level, and overall, that ended in failure. Without a ton of static pressure provided by server chassis fans, there just aren't a lot of options to keep the card cool with traditional PC fans. Between the difficulties in cooling these GPUs, along with the trial and error required to get them rendering games and applications on the desktop, I figured the best thing to do was send them back home to the server rack where they'd be more comfortable. The only problem is, because the cards have no video outputs, without support of vGPU drivers, they just won't work for rendering desktop sessions inside virtual machines. But this is Craft Computing, and I'm Jeff. Surely, somewhere in the research that I've done with vGPU, GPUP, and Windows graphics switching, there's going to be some method of getting these to not only render games, but allow for a fully GPU-accelerated desktop experience inside of a virtual machine. And you know what? I found one. This method right now works for Windows virtual machines only, and while I've tested this out in Proxmox, it should work with pretty much any other hypervisor that's out there. You'll also need PCI Express pass-through support enabled both in BIOS and on your hypervisor. For the video card today, I'm going to be working with an NVIDIA Tesla K80, a dual GPU Kepler-based enterprise card. Each GPU on board has 2,495 CUDA cores and 12GB of GDDR5 memory. I benchmarked this card a couple weeks ago, and while I didn't feel performance was worth it at the $170 asking price for a single PC, being able to use this card to power two virtual machines at the same time makes it a much more enticing option. Now, while I'm going to be focusing on the K80 today, in theory, this method should work for any headless GPU, that is, any enterprise GPU that doesn't have a display output. For today's setup, I've got the K80 installed in my Epic 7742 server, Proxmox 6.4 as a hypervisor, and Windows 10 21H1 in the virtual machine. And again, while it is not possible to use the K80 with NVIDIA Grid, because there are two GPUs on this card, we will still be able to assign each GPU to its own VM. To start off, you'll need to enable IOMMU support. This is a pretty simple process with just a few lines that need modified inside Proxmox. You'll also need to make sure IOMMU is enabled in your BIOS. For Intel systems, this is called Intel VTD. AMD calls it AMDVI, or simply IOMMU. Each BIOS is going to be a little bit different, so refer to your motherboard manual to locate the proper settings. Next, we're going to boot up into Proxmox and get things ready to go. Type in /etc/default/grub, and then find the line that says grub command line linux default. After quiet, you're going to want to add either AMD IOMMU equals on or Intel IOMMU equals on, depending on which CPU you have inside your server. Don't forget to make sure the quote marks are closed at the end of the line. Then press Ctrl X to exit, Y to save, and Enter to confirm the file name. Next, type in update-grub to apply your changes. Once that's done, type in /etc/modules. Here, we're going to enter the modules needed for IOMMU and VFIO support, which will allow us to pass through PCI devices into VMs. And don't worry, you can always copy and paste these from the instructions I've linked down in the video description. With the four modules entered in, go ahead and exit and save your changes. Finally, you'll need to blacklist your GPU drivers inside Proxmox. And again, you can just copy and paste these commands. Each of them adds the relevant GPU drivers to the ModProbe blacklist, preventing Proxmox from using these devices. With that done, type in update-initramfs-u and go ahead and reboot your server. With Proxmox booted back up, it's time to set up our Windows Virtual Machine. Configuration is pretty straightforward if you've set up a VM before, with just a couple things you need to watch out for. Under Guest OS type, make sure to select Windows, otherwise you'll have some driver issues, specifically when it comes to network adapters. Under the System tab, you'll want to make sure the Advanced box is checked. The BIOS type is going to be OVMF UEFI. For the machine type, select Q35. Then select your storage location for the UEFI boot disk. This will be a very small bootable file, only around 5 megabytes in size. Set up your storage, CPU, and memory as you normally would, but make sure to uncheck ballooning device under memory, as we want to allocate the entire memory block to keep our GPU as stable as possible. After that, just finish out the VM wizard and click on finish. Before you start your virtual machine, let's go ahead and forward the GPU to it now, as there's no reason to wait until after the OS is installed. Click on your virtual machine and go over to the Hardware tab, then click on the Add pull-down menu and select PCI device. Under the Device pull-down menu, find your GPU core. In my case, it is the GK210 Tesla K80, which has two physical GPUs on the same card. When setting up a second virtual machine, you'll want to select the second GPU in this list. Now, as a note, you can set up a single PCI device to forward to more than one virtual machine, but you can't have more than one of those turned on at the same time. On the Add Devices window, check the All Functions and PCIe boxes, and then click on Add. Note, do not click on the primary GPU box, as that will actually prevent the card from working properly in the virtual machine. With that, your virtual machine should now be ready to install Windows. Go ahead and run through the setup process, and I'll see you back here when you're ready to move on to the GPU configuration inside of Windows. See you in a couple minutes. For anyone who's followed my GPU pass-through tutorials in the past, there is a very familiar list of required software to install. First off, you'll need to go to nvidia.com/drivers and download the latest Tesla driver pack for your GPU. Again, in my case, I'll be downloading the Tesla K80 drivers, version 471.41. Once downloaded, just install them as you normally would. A link to everything else you need will be down in the video description. There's VB Cable, which is a virtual audio device for Windows. This allows sound to work without the need for a physical audio output, and go ahead and install that one now as well. And here's where the list gets a little weird, as you're going to need to install a VNC server for remote access while we're setting things up, as neither the Proxmox console nor remote desktop will show us the display adapter we're going to be adding. For that, I'll be installing TypeVNC. Run the installer and make sure to enable VNC server as an always-on service. This will allow us to access the VM through VNC, even at the Windows login screen. Finally, you'll need to download the USB MMIDD Virtual Display Adapter driver, as well as Parsec Streaming Server from parsec.app. But don't install them just yet. We've got a couple tweaks we need to make inside Windows first. If you remember in my Tesla K80 review, while the GPU was rated to have a boost clock of 875 MHz, when trying to play games, it wasn't able to run above the base clock of 565 MHz. A BIOS mod was able to get me running at full speed, but there is an easier way to enable boost functionality. Open up a command prompt window as administrator and navigate to C, Program Files, NVIDIA Corporation, NVSMI. Now type in NVIDIA SMI-DM0. This will change the driver mode from compute only to WDDM mode, enabling NVIDIA Boost. We also need to make a registry change to allow the GPU to render 3D applications. Just like the original K80 video, the registry path is a little obscure, so make sure you follow the instructions down below. Inside the folder with your Tesla K80, you'll want to delete the adapter type registry value. You'll need to restart your virtual machine for both those changes to take effect, so go ahead and do that now. Once Windows is booted back up, you'll want to access it over VNC, as we're going to be doing some weird things with the virtual displays. First off, go to the USB MMIDD zip folder and unzip the contents to C:/USB MMIDD. Open up that folder, right-click on the USB MMIDD batch file, and run it as administrator. Your VNC console should automatically resize and show you two displays, your virtual console from Proxmox, as well as a virtual 1080p monitor. It's this 1080p monitor that lets all the magic happen for gaming, as we're going to set up Parsec to use this monitor with GPU acceleration. go ahead and run the Parsec installer now. You'll want to make sure to select Shared Installation to allow Parsec to run as a service. That way we can again access Windows from the login screen. Once Parsec is installed, go ahead and log in or create an account if you don't have one already. Parsec is free to use, but you do have to create an account and log in to use it. Once you've logged into Parsec, open up the application, go to the Settings menu, followed by the Host tab. For resolution, make sure to select 1920 by 1080, as the virtual display driver we're using is only capable of running up to 1080p. If you select a higher resolution, or your client does, all you'll get when connecting to Parsec is a black screen. Under bandwidth limit, I usually increase this to at least 25 megabit to get the best results. And lastly, under display, grab the pull-down menu and select generic PNP monitor. It should show up as the second option in the list. The generic non-PNP monitor is the display added by Proxmox and will not work inside Parsec. With those changes made, go ahead and close out of Parsec. And finally, there's one last step, and that's to start our virtual display with Windows and disable Proxmox's default display. Right-click on the desktop and go to Display Properties. Here we're going to disable display number 1, letting Windows only use the display adapter that we installed. Head near the bottom of the window and select the Multiple Displays pull-down menu. Select Show Only on Monitor 2, and then confirm when asked by Windows. Again, your VNC console should have automatically been resized, but this time with a single 1080p display. Next, open up Notepad, as we're going to create a very simple batch script. Type in c:/usbmmidd/deviceinstaller64 enable IDD 1. Save the file as start.bat in the usbmmidd directory and close Notepad. And finally, the last step is to make the batch file run at Windows startup. Click on the Start button and type in gpedit.msc. This will bring up the Group Policy Editor. Under Computer Configuration, open up Windows Settings and then Scripts, then double-click on Startup. In the new window, click on Add and then browse to C:/usbmmidd and select the start.bat file we created a moment ago. If everything looks correct, click on OK and close out of the Group Policy Editor. With all that done, reboot your virtual machine one last time, and we can finally get to some gaming. After all that work, what do you say we finally get into some gameplay? So if I jump on over to Proxmox here, you can see my VM has booted back up. Now I'm going to go ahead and launch the Parsec client here on my computer and we'll connect to the VM. So there is our computer, K80-02. I'm going to go ahead and click connect. And just like that, we are inside Windows. And because we can see the desktop, we know the NVIDIA card is doing exactly what it should be doing. If it weren't working properly, all we would be getting right now is a black screen. But the real proof is, does this actually work for playing games? So let's go ahead and fire up Grand Theft Auto and find out. Now that I'm into the game, let's go ahead and take a look at our settings. So first and foremost, you can see that I have 12 gigabytes of video memory available on this video card, which is absolutely insane to see in GTA 5. But let's go ahead and go all the way to the top here and I'll walk you through. First up, we are at 1080p. I do have FXAA enabled and MSAA disabled. The reason being is MSAA is a pretty major performance hit, and this card, while capable of running GTA 5 at 60 frames per second, does need all the help it can get sometimes. VSync is disabled, obviously. I do have the population and variety scaled all the way up, as well as distance scaling. And pretty much we have a mix of very high and high settings down here for the rest of it. And down here under Advanced Graphics, you can see I have all the optional sliders all the way up as well, included extended distance scaling, which is quite a hit on both the CPU and the GPU. So let's see how it does. Can I just say I love the fact that I have this in an air-conditioned server rack, because my GPU under 100% load is sitting at 33 degrees Celsius right now. Can't get anywhere in the city unless you take a cab. No! I wanted to hijack the cab. Stupid thing. There, now I can drive the cab. So even at moderately high settings, we are running right at 60 frames per second, which is fantastic. And again, I do feel that I am inside of a virtual machine and playing remotely. There's a little bit of compression artifacts going on, but honestly, latency is not that bad at all, and this is a overall fantastic experience. Ooh, look at that. It's a way better ride. I don't know why they're chasing me. I gave the car back. But I gotta say, performance-wise, I am absolutely impressed. Now, let me show you the really cool thing about this particular video card, the Tesla K80. So, I've been playing GTA 5 this whole time, but remember, there are two GPUs on this card, both of which can be passed through independently to their own virtual machines. So, if I exit out of Parsec, and then go to K8001, which is the machine I set up to test all of this, this has been running Heaven Benchmark the entire time. Pretty sweet, right? So again, if you wanted to set up a couple of gaming virtual machines for remote play, or you wanted to have one virtual gaming machine and a Plex encoder going on another, this is totally a viable solution to do that. And at $170, quite an affordable one. The biggest reason I didn't recommend picking up a Tesla K80 in my previous video was mainly centered around not being able to use the card outside of a Windows PC. Sure, you could enable graphics switching and use one of the GPUs, but one of the GPUs and 12GB of video RAM would inevitably sit idle, and that just seemed like a waste. Being able to virtualize each K80 inside of its own virtual machine means this card is a much more compelling offer, as you could have a virtual gaming machine on one VM and dedicate the other GPU to a Plex server for NVENC encoding. Have your kids been bugging you about getting a gaming PC of their own? Buy a Raspberry Pi 400 and a 1080p monitor and virtualize the rest. Or just have a dedicated virtual machine for gaming on the go and stream through Parsec to your phone or handheld gaming system. Looking for a little bit more horsepower? The Tesla M40, while only having a single GPU, offers more than double the performance of a single Tesla K80 GPU. And in theory, you should be able to partition this inside Windows Hyper-V using the method I showed today, again making that a much more tempting offer. I may have to explore GPU-P on the Tesla M40 in a future video. But for now, if you're interested in picking up either of these cards, I will have eBay affiliate links down in the video description, as well as a full tutorial write-up from today's video. On your way down there, make sure to drop this video a like and subscribe to Craft Computing if you haven't done so already. Follow me on Twitter at Craft Computing to keep up with daily shenanigans like this. And if you like the content you see on this channel and want to help support me in what I do, go buy some merch from craftcomputing.store or hit me up on Patreon or Floatplane. Links are also down in the video description. Thank you all so much for watching this one, and as always, I will see you in the next video. Cheers, guys. Today's beer was sent in by longtime fan of the show, John Jay. This is the Perfect Storm from Treehouse Brewing, a double IPA clocking in at 8%. It's kind of like a mandarin orange and grapefruit, maybe. Definitely interesting. Helps if I don't shove it up my nose, though. It's definitely leaning more towards the hazy IPA, as I'm sure you can probably tell, in this fantastic glass that you can pick up from craftcomputing.store. It's definitely got a little bit of that acid bite, but it's actually surprisingly smooth and a little bit creamy. Very citrus forward, not really drying in the mouth at all. In fact, it's got a nice thick body to it. Little sweet, little citrusy, kind of like it. Okay, I'm about 3 or 4 ounces in, probably closer to 3. There's that acid burn. It's definitely picking up some steam there. I like this one, but kind of like a lot of hazies, the flavor just kind of dissipates within the first couple of ounces of it. It's got some really, really solid flavors there, especially if you love those really high citrus, juicy leaning hazy IPAs. But at the end of the day, I feel this one's going to fade pretty fast.